Well, that is so true there. My name's Giles Bryant and welcome to Veganic Gardeners Question Time. What a wonderful introduction there to the work of the Vegan Organic Network. Absolutely. Well, we have a fantastic show for you today. It is World Vegan Day and we are super excited about it. And I would like to introduce the wonderful experts today on our panel on this special Veganic Gardeners Question Time. And first of all, I'd like to introduce Ellen Mary. Ellen is a horticultural radio show host. She's a TV presenter, writer, and of course, she is vegan. She's traveled all over the world to discuss the benefits that nature provides to our well-being and specifically of gardening. Her first book, The Joy of Gardening, The Everyday Zen of Mowing the Lawn, was released earlier in the year in May. So welcome, Ellen. How are you doing?
Thank you very much. Hi, everybody. Happy World Vegan Day. It's a good day.
Oh, we were just chatting before the show and you're super excited today, aren't you? Just tell people a little bit about what's going on for you later on after the show.
Well, I've got my brother-in-law and sister staying with us and they're not vegan. So my husband and I, who are vegan, have basically been taking them everywhere where they can get the most amazing vegan food. And this evening we're taking them out to a restaurant which is called Oh My Soul. And they just do like the best food and we cannot wait to have a big feast of plant-based food, no animals harmed.
Oh, absolutely beautiful. Well, I tell you what, if you're going to celebrate World Vegan Day, do it in style. Absolutely. Ellen, look forward to hearing from you later. Ladies and gentlemen, our next guest and panel expert is Piers Warren. He's a conservationist, an author, and a keen grower of organic fruit and vegetables. And he's the founder of Wildeye, the International School of Wildlife Filmmaking. He's the writer of several books and he's co-authored The Vegan Cook and Gardener. Welcome, Piers.
Thank you very much. Nice to see you. Nice to be here.
Yeah, welcome, my friend. So how are you doing today? How's World Vegan Day been for you?
Well, it's been great because I've been visited by my daughter and my grandson. And it's my daughter who I wrote the book The Vegan Cook and Gardener with. And right now, both of them are downstairs waiting for me when the show's over.
Wonderful. Wonderful to be with family as well. And we're going to get into a question a little bit later about our favourite seasonal dish. So look forward to what yours is there, Piers. Warm welcome. And our final panellist today is Meghan Kelly. And Meg learned veganic permaculture to become more self-sufficient while sticking to her vegan values. She's practiced veganics for over 10 years in community gardens, concrete jungles, and also up in the hills. She runs the Learn Veganic online course and co-founded the Veganic Agriculture Network. Welcome along to the show, Meg.
Hi there. How are you doing today?
Oh, really well, really well. Now, you look extremely healthy. How have you been celebrating World Vegan Day?
No, I always think of every day as being World Vegan Day, so...
Hallelujah. It's absolutely so true. I remember the folk singer Donovan, he said that every day should be St. Valentine's Day. You know, we should really have this focus. So really look forward to getting into some of the questions today with you, Meghan. Very excited about it. So I tell you what, why don't we actually kick off this show, Veganic Gardeners Question Time. We're going to kick the show off now with our first question. And this is from Janet Flynn. Thanks for the question, Janet. And Janet asks, for two older people currently 67 years of age, with average appetites, who want to be self-sufficient in growing their own vegetables, knowing that their appetites might decrease a bit with each decade, how many square meters, obviously we're into a metric world here, of growing space, do you think we need to consider? Janet says she's happy to buy dried beans, lentils, nuts, seeds, citrus fruits, bread and bread flour. So who would like to get into this one then?
I can talk about that a bit.
Please do, Meghan. We'd love to hear what you think.
So, I mean, first of all, I would say rather than focusing on what's the minimum number of square meters that you need, to focus on how many square meters you can manage really well. Because sometimes if people will create really large gardens and they're not managed well, they could have created half a, you know, a garden half the size and had just as many veggies from it. But if we look at the numbers for self-sufficiency, if we look at, you know, all your food needs, it might be about a quarter of an acre per person. But if we're looking at just, you know, fruits and veggies and you're buying in all of those other things, it might be about 50 square meters for two older adults, because often we talk about about 100 square meters for a family of four. So I would just cut that in two. But you might also want to consider other elements, like, do you have enough space in your garden to be growing biomass to feed back to the garden, and putting in perennial plants that will be more self-sufficient. So not to think of gardening for self-sufficiency just in terms of, you know, how much food it will bring to us, but also can the garden itself be self-sufficient over time? Are we, you know, growing a lot of biomass-rich plants that we can feed back to the soil? Another thing to consider too is, you know, if you are looking at doing kind of calorie cropping instead of just kind of some of the basic fruits and veggies like lettuce and potatoes, there are some certain crops like potatoes and parsnips and even onions that actually are pretty high calorie. So if you're trying to kind of reduce your overall groceries and grow some really high calorie crops, you can look into some of those ones. And there's the Ecology Action Network in California that really goes into calorie cropping and how to grow as many calories as possible from a certain number of square meters.
Well, thank you, Meghan. I mean, what wonderful information. I think you've certainly put a bit of thought into that question, and such an important thing. I think a lot of people, any of you other guys got any thoughts for Janet there? Yes, Piers.
Yeah, just to add that on your space, your land, if you've also got cover in the form of either greenhouse or polytunnel, or ideally both, then that can also make a difference, because growing under cover as well as extending your season can be very productive. So that will increase the amount of calories and variety of plants that you can grow.
Absolutely, like, very wonderful words there. Certainly things for us to think about. Okay, we're gonna move on now to our second question today. And this is from Kev, Kev Meany. And Kev asks, I have a small market using a no-dig method, and he grows in permanent beds of well-rotted horse manure. But he'd like to move away from this into using green manure and cover crops. What's the best way to go about this? And how are cover crops used in a no-dig system? Now, Kev, it's not just you who wants to know about this. I want to know about this too. I've had my first ever year in the garden, a veganic, growing my fruit and vegetables. So though I've been a vegan myself for about 25 years, and I like eating organic food, I'm only quite new to this myself. So, Kev, we're asking this for you and myself. So, panel, who'd like to have a go at this? Ellen.
Yeah, I can give you a bit of information based upon kind of what I've done and some of the no-dig research that I've looked into as well. So, obviously, you know, cover crops, for anyone else who are listening, are, it's a means to put back into the soil rather than the plants that take out. And generally, they're sown over an area to keep the weeds down, to replenish the soil, usually over the winter months, and then you dig them back into the soil and it improves the structure and all the nutrients as well. It can be great if you can't get hold of any veganic mulch, or you don't have enough space for making lots of your own homemade compost to mulch with as well. There's lots of other benefits to having cover crops. There's generally three groups, and they are, now I need to remember, things like peas, clover and vetch, so the legumes. There's broadleaf, so that's mustard, and grains as well are also used, so like wheat and oat and rye and such like. So depending on where you are and what you're kind of looking at, so there's a few different options. I don't know into each of those heavily. They each will do different things to your soil. Of course, it can benefit wildlife as well to have your cover crops on the soil. Now, I've used mustard on my allotment. I have a two half an allotments that make up the full size. I used mustard. I dug that in very early spring, and I'd say it worked really well. The soil where I used it was quite heavy, and I used that for I think I'd done 2 or 3 years of that, and it did help the soil a lot. However, there might be some good news if you haven't got time or you don't have the ability to do that for some people out there. And I was actually researching the fact that by using the no dig gardening method, you probably don't even need to use cover crops at all if you have enough mulch or, you know, homemade compost, because just layering 3 centimeters of that, if you have it each year annually in autumn or spring, is enough to replenish the soil anyway, and you don't need to use cover crops unless you're using it, of course, to keep down weeds. But I'm assuming if you're using no dig, you probably don't have a lot of weeds anyway, so you can go one way or the other. And I found that on my allotment now, which is Veganic and no dig as well, so I don't use cover crops anymore because I just simply don't need to, because the soil and all the wonderful creatures and microorganisms that live in the soil are doing all of the work for you. So yeah, there's many options, of course, but if you can and you do have space to make your own compost, then that's the best way to go, and you probably don't need to use cover crops at all, whilst they are beneficial for many reasons. That's my answer.
Well, that is an absolutely fantastic answer, and I'll tell you what, it does make a lot of sense to me. Anyone else, any other of the panel want to jump in on that, or should we move on?
I could just add as Ellen Mary mentioned, you know, we often don't use cover crops quite as much in no-dig techniques, but one way that we can use them is in our pathways. So for example, we can grow things like clover in our pathways, and that can really cut down on the number of weeds that you might have in your paths. And then, you know, after it goes to flower, you can chop it down and then put it onto your beds as a mulch. So it's kind of a sort of cover crop, sort of not, but a cover crop of sorts. And you can also look at things that you can plant late in the fall that might die off in the winter. So that way you're not actually turning it back into the soil, but you're just letting it die off on its own and lay on the surface kind of as a mulch. So one thing that I'll sometimes do is I'll plant things like mustard greens late in the fall. I'll eat a lot of the mustard greens, but some of them will just sort of die off on the soil. And even things like right at the end of the season, if you're maybe like 3 weeks away from your first frosts, you can do things like wheatgrass and pea shoots, where basically you end up getting this like end of season harvest in about a week or two. And then whatever's left is just going to, die off and get incorporated into your garden through the action of the microorganisms that are there.
Okay. Sorry, can I just say, Meghan, the path idea is amazing. Why had I not thought of that? I love that idea.
Yeah, Helen Atho, who's a kind of a veganic farmer and researcher in North America, she's really popularized that idea. She does mow and blow, where she basically has, you know, a wide variety of green manure kind of style crops. She calls it, I guess, living mulching techniques, but it's kind of just in the pathway, very close to the beds, and then she mows it and blows it directly onto the beds.
I love that.
It's amazing as well when things work together in nature. Mm. I mean, mm-hmm. I'm drinking here some tea, which is sea buckthorn from my friend's forest garden, a maypole forest garden. Hope to get John Barker on as one of the panelists soon. And it was very interesting. He's planted such a diverse range on this 6-acre plot, and he's put in Italian alder, which is said to help fix the nitrogen into the soil. And where he's planted the alder, the sea buckthorn is so vibrant in the plant. Wow. It's proof. It's actually, you know, you can see the proof of it. And I know we've all experienced this. Shall we move on to the next question? This is from Lucy, who's from Stroud. And Lucy asks, panel, I have moved into a new house which has a mature grapevine in the greenhouse. It's looking pretty bedraggled and out of control now that the leaves and grapes from the summer have gone. How should I prune it so it fruits well next year? Excellent question, Lucy. Over to you, panel. Who'd like to have a go? Piers, over to you, my friend.
Yes, well, there are various different methods of pruning grapevines. The most common one is called the rod and spur method, and this is particularly appropriate for grapes that are growing indoors in a greenhouse, for example, and also for grapes that are growing maybe against a wall. It's also known as the cordon method. So basically, you have your main stem, which is called the rod, and then off that you will have the spurs. And at this time of year, when the fruiting is finished and the leaves are starting to fall, it can look a right mess, as Lucy said, especially if it hasn't been pruned properly for a while. So the best time to do this is probably the end of this month, certainly when all the leaves have finished falling. And basically, you just follow the rod or the main stem up. And whenever you come to a spur, you want to cut it right back and leave only one or two buds on each spur. And while you're doing it, you can also remove anything that looks damaged or diseased or is just too congested. So by the time you've done this to the whole thing, it will look very bare. It will look just like the main stem with a few little spurs sticking out. But that's absolutely fine. That's what you want, because next spring but they will start to grow vigorously again. Very much pruning for an established vine, Lucy has. If you're pruning a new vine, then there are various other ways of doing that to make sure it grows in a productive manner. And also bear in mind that this is just the winter pruning. So in the spring and summer, you'll need to do a further prune as well. So for example, if you're growing dessert grapes, then for each spur, you'll want to cut off some of the flower heads. So you basically just have one bunch of grapes per spur. If you're doing it for winemaking, then it doesn't matter so much. You can have as many bunches as you want. Yes, that's the rod and spur method, which sounds perfect for your tree, Lucy.
Well, thank you very much, Piers. I think a very comprehensive answer. So we're going to move on again. This is a question that I would be asking as well. This is from Dave from Tewkesbury. Thank you for your question, Dave. Dave asks, my allotment feels fairly dormant now. Yeah, my beds do too, Dave. Is there anything I should be planting or sowing now for the year ahead? Okay, panel, over to you. Who's got some thoughts here? Ellen, Mary.
We probably all have some thoughts on this one. I actually really love this time of year. So I know obviously we've finished like the summer harvest and stuff, but perhaps you've got some brassicas growing for over winter and maybe some Christmas potatoes as well, that kind of thing. But I always find like when you strip everything back, it's like nature at it. I just love it. It's like nature at its best. You're mulching the soil, you're preparing for like the months ahead. There's so much you can do at this time of year. If it's not frozen or not really, really waterlogged, for example, even into November, you can be planting your garlics, your shallots, your onions. You can sow broad beans. You can sow winter lettuce or salad greens like mizuna. You could do winter gem. It's a good time of year for planting things like rhubarb crowns. If you haven't got your rhubarb, get that in now, as long as the soil again isn't too waterlogged or frozen. Things like strawberry plants, if you've got your strawberry runners, get them out. Raspberry plants, bare root shrubs and trees at this time of year. So you know, roses, any of your fruit trees, they can all be planted out between November and March. And apart from all of the things that you can still sow and grow at this time of year, it's also mulching. And that's honestly, I think it's one of my favorite jobs on the allotment, apart from harvesting. It's like replenishing the soil is one of the best things. Without good soil, we don't have life on earth, and that is included on your allotment, you know. So mulching is really important at this time of year, especially if, you know, if you're no dig as well, you want to get that out right now. So there's just so much. And like Piers mentioned earlier on about extending your season if you do happen to have cover. So if you have a greenhouse or even cloches outside, all those salad leaves are great, microgreens, that kind of thing. There's loads that you can still do it this year. I think we're very conditioned to think the harvests end at the end of summer, you know, apart from our winter veg, but there's still plenty. And if the weather happens to be quite mild where you are as well, and we know that the climate is changing and we are looking at higher temperatures, you will be able to sow and grow a little bit, you know, longer out of the main season. But I love this time of year. I almost feel like you're sort of cheating the theory when you're sowing and growing at this time of year, you know, like, and I always give things a little go that you might not think would grow at this time of year. You know, have a go and see what happens. So yeah, get your salad sown, get your broad beans sown, sweet peas. So if you've got an allotment and you want to have some lovely, you know, beautiful scent next year as well, get those in quick, usually October, but you could still be doing that now. So sow your sweet peas. So yeah, loads of stuff basically on the allotment, and just get out there and enjoy it, even if it's cold.
Well, I tell you what, Dave, you're going to be busy, my friend. I wonder if Piers or Meghan has got anything else that they would like to give Dave to a few more jobs. Piers, over to you.
Well, Ellen mentioned just about everything there, certainly all the ideas I had. But just to say a bit more about garlic, November is the classic time of year for sowing garlic outdoors. And the reason for doing that is that they will perform better next year if they've gone through a period of cold in the ground. But bear in mind that if your plot of land is very waterlogged, for example, if you have a clay soil that holds a lot of water, there is the danger of the garlic cloves that you plant rotting before they can actually start growing. So that if that is the case, just plant the garlic cloves into modules and then with compost, and then put them somewhere cold, like a cold frame or an unheated greenhouse or even a shed, and they will get going and go through this period of cold. And then when we get into the spring, they will then have good roots and shoots, and you can then plant them out into your bed.
That is a fantastic tip. So Meghan, have you got anything else to, because I think Dave, sure, might have regretted asking the question, mate. You got some good work. Meghan, give him a little bit more. What else?
Sure. I think Ellen Mary covered pretty much everything. I would just give an extra vote for all the types of perennial onion style plants that we can plant at this time of year, like green onions. There's Egyptian walking onions. There's potato onions that are a type of bunching onion. Oftentimes, I mean, that's one of the things I appreciate the most in my garden is oniony things that come back year after year, because they're there first thing in the spring. They just, once you planted them once, you don't have to plant them again. And also I'd say that we can also think about what we can plant now that will be beneficial for pollinators in the spring. So there's a lot of perennial flowers that we can put in, like daylilies, and there's also things like calendula that, you know, if we put the seeds down now, they'll just pop up in the spring. So we can think about the ways that we can support the pollinators around us.
Wonderful, absolutely wonderful words. You know, as you're all talking here, it's really made me think, I wish we could get the message of the veganic growing and agriculture to the people currently meeting in Glasgow at the COP26. And it's a very interesting angle with this, as Dan from Vegan Organic Network said to me, that there's no, that animal agriculture is not on the agenda at COP26. In Glasgow, and it seems that they're missing the point somewhat. And I think one of the best things we can do is to share the knowledge and our examples and productivity and health and well-being and all of these really positive things, and to share that positive message. And I think we're actually going to be joined now by one of the team from Glasgow. Kerry, are you there? I don't know if Kerry is with us. Kerry, are you there from Glasgow, from COP?
wildlife emergency. It's a wildlife emergency. It's a wildlife emergency. It's a wildlife emergency.
Hey Kerry, how's it going?
Great, go vegan, save the planet.
Well, there we go. That was a little bit of footage today from the streets of Glasgow, where we see the Von Trike in action. I think a fantastic idea from Dan to get this trike and to cycle around playing all these wonderful videos. And then you saw one of my entries into the Von competition there, the Wildlife Emergency. So I'm just going to throw this in there quickly, panel, because I think it's very topical as this climate, you know, conference is taking place. Many dignitaries are attending. What would your message be, panel, if you could share a message, you know, maybe a minute to the people, to the world, really, about you know. But from your perspective, how you see it. So over to you. Who'd like to start?
Okay, I'm happy to, but I could go on for a really long time.
Just give us a minute.
Okay, so I still find it absolutely incredible how cognitive dissonance is so real in our world, in the human brain. And I think when you start to take a vegan journey, you really learn about your own health, your own well-being, your own body, your own needs. It opens your mind up to the world and gardening and the planets and just our connection with everything, and it makes you feel so much better. So selfishly, in that respect, going vegan does that. But then, of course, there are animals that are being slaughtered all around the world, millions and millions of animals, just because we want to taste a bit of bacon, which still blows my mind that we do that too. But with regards to COP, at the end of the day, this is about the climate. One of the biggest issues is animal agriculture. And until the powers that be, the dignitaries, whatever you want to call them, actually face this, you know, front on, deal with this and forget profit and money and politics, what an amazingly more peaceful world that we would live in, you know? And if we're talking about cognitive dissonance in just us everyday people, it is in those politicians more than anybody else, you know, that it's just, they need to get a grip. It is a climate emergency, and we actually have solutions to that. They're there. We know them. We're gardening veganically. We know we can do this, you know. Why are they not listening, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I totally second that, but I tell you what, they are going to be listening, because there's the Von Trike taking the message there. And we saw earlier on in that video, Kerry. Now, we're hoping that Kerry's going to be able to join us actually live from Glasgow, linking up with these wonders of modern technology. Kerry, can you hear us?
Yes, I can now. Sorry about the previous technological problems there.
So, Kerry, you are reporting for us from Glasgow, from COP26. Please, can you tell us, how is it going?
It's going great. There are so many plant-based vegan organisations here. We've met up with obviously Viva today, and we've met up with the Vegan Society, and we're here with the Plant-Based Treaty. Would you like to speak to someone from the Plant-Based Treaty, tell you all about it?
Well, why not? Let's have a quick chat with them.
Excellent. Okay. So I'm going to introduce, this is Kat. One moment. Okay. So this is Kat here.
Hi.
So can you tell us about the Plant-Based Treaty?
Yeah, so it's a global initiative to try shift towards a more green, more ethical, more sustainable plant-based diet. We're trying to get politicians, individuals, businesses, groups, communities, just everyone to back this up and say that, yeah, we need a plant-based food system or we're going to face environmental catastrophe, like climate chaos, ecological breakdown, etc. And we need to act now. We need to say that, you know, plant-based alternatives are more just healthier, more sustainable, more ethical for the planet, for everyone, for all parties. It's easier for the farmers as well. They don't have to like work as well. Well, that's a great area. But anyways, like shift subsidies. We have three aims basically. It's relinquish, redirect, and restore. So we have to relinquish, as in stop all buildings, future projects of animal ag, and then redirect all those subsidies to plant-based agriculture to help farmers transition to a more sustainable way of living. And then we use remaining land, remaining water and crops, etc., to just like rewild the whole world, reforest, you know, instead of chopping trees to grow feed, we can use that land to do other stuff. I don't know, anything better.
Thank
make
you.
The world a greener place. But yeah, that's basically like a vague breakdown of everything.
Wonderful. Well, that's wonderful.
Any questions? Or sorry, what was that?
What are you doing here?
Oh, what am I doing? Well, I'm just helping out. I'm very big on animal rights and like sustainability and like climate justice, stuff like that, etc. Right now, I'm just helping a lot of plant-based treaty. Obviously, we're here in a light show, trying to encourage, it's quite quiet right now, but we encourage people to dance. We've got a dance, we've got like free vegan chocolate, vegan energy drinks. If they endorse the plant-based tree, just go on the website plantbasedtree.org and put in your details. Obviously, we need as much support and the backing of people to back this up as possible. And yeah, I study at Strathclyde, so we just finished the conference of our plant-based street stand at the conference of youth COI16, and that's my university, that's where I study. And it was good, it was really busy. I had a lot of students endorsing the student parliament, student union backed up the plant-based treaty. We had the cow in the room, a massive giant inflatable cow, got some good pictures of that. And yeah, and hopefully we'll be back there during these 2 weeks, but we'll have like lots more around Glasgow and during COP time. So yeah, and happy to answer any questions or anything.
Wonderful. Well, thank you for joining us. Thank you ever so much, and thank you, Kerry, for signing us.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you, and keep up the good work taking the Von Trike around Glasgow, and to all of the people there, sharing the message of the vegan and the organic future for the planet. So thank you very much for joining us from Glasgow and COP26.
Great, thank you.
Thank you.
Is this being recorded?
Yeah, live.
Oh, that's live.
That's it, you're being broadcast live around the world, my friend, yes. And we're doing it. Kerry, just a quick word from you, please, before we get back to the panel.
Sure.
I just want to know, how's it been on the trike today, on the Von Trike, cycling around Glasgow?
Well, the Von Trike arrived quite late, but even though it arrived quite late, we did cause a bit of a stir in the centre of the high street here. Had plenty of people coming up and having a look, particularly the kids. They absolutely love all of the designs on there. So yeah, I'm looking forward to tomorrow when we'll be riding the trike around much more.
Yeah, and you had a very beautiful message. It was a simple message and a short message. I think one we can all agree on. It was go vegan. Save the planet.
Exactly, exactly. Nothing better than vegan organic.
Well, vegan organic can save the planet. We can do it. Oh, what a wonderful message. Well, Kerry, thank you so much for joining us today live.
Thank you.
And thank you for our technical wizards for really making this happen. A live broadcast here during World Vegan Day, Gardeners, the Veganic Gardeners Question Time. Thank you very much, Kerry.
Thank you. Bye, everyone.
Bye-bye. Thank you. Wonderful. So I would just like to hear, just if we can, just for about a minute, from Piers and Meghan, your message. We're going to call them dignitaries. We could call them many things. We're polite here. We'll call them the people of the world. Meghan, over to you first of all, please. What's your message? Just give us it in a minute.
Sure. I think, you know, typically when we talk about veganism, you know, we think about the domesticated animals and the terrible conditions that they're suffering. But one thing that Vaughn has really brought attention to recently is the plight of wild animals in this situation too. And there was a study done a number of years ago that showed that, you know, if you weighed all the land mammals in the world, 36% are humans, 60% are land mammals, and only 4% are wild. And that's something that's kind of an astounding number that we never draw attention to, really. So I think that we need to be realizing, you know, just the extent of impact that animal agriculture has on wild habitats too. You know, as someone just mentioned about subsidies, you know, from, you know, the most basic place we can start is by no longer subsidizing animal agriculture, knowing its negative impacts. We have to go much farther than that, but that's just the most basic place we can start.
Wonderful words. So, Piers, over to you, please. Just a minute. What would your message be to the world about this issue?
Well, I completely agree with everything that Ellen and Meghan said. If you look back a few years and you asked people why they'd gone vegan, the majority would say they went vegan for animal welfare reasons and also for environmental reasons. And then all the health benefits were just sort of an added bonus, really. But these days, there are an increasing number of people who are turning vegan for environmental reasons, for climate change reasons, because they are gradually learning the extent to which animal agriculture is contributing to the climate change that we don't want. Yet our politicians, they seem to increasingly be talking about using renewable energy and less fossil fuels and maybe even flying less if they're brave enough, but hardly any of them brave enough to say we've really got to change the way we eat and we've got to stop eating meat. And we don't want to dilly-dally around with just meat-free Mondays or something like that. We've just got to go for it. As Prince Charles said today, we're on a war footing. And when you're on a war footing, you don't dilly-dally about making tiny changes here or there. You've got to completely go for it. So my message for all the politicians out there is this is your chance to be brave and tell people the facts.
Yeah. I couldn't agree more. Take action. Don't just say the words. Just actually be brave enough to do it. Like, we have answers. We have solutions. Like, just do it. Oh, my gosh.
Do you know, if we could get the three of you, and I really hope we can get this this Veganic Gardeners Question Time shared to people and really shared out there. So if you're listening, please do share this and really get this out there, because the wisdom of these people here, we have the solutions. And I think this is one of the most wonderful things. I remember going to the Big Green Gathering Festival here in England over 20 years ago, 20,000 people powered by the wind and the sun and people power on the bikes in the rave tent, you know, pedaling. And I thought, they're doing it. A bunch of hippies are doing it. Crikey, we can do it. Okay, panel, we Dan said to me, he said, just have fun, don't worry about getting through the questions. However, Sarah from Cardiff, I know you're very keen to get this answered, and I think this is going to be a great one. Does the panel have a favorite autumnal dish made from produce from the plot? Ooh, World Vegan Day. Come on, give it to us. Who wants to go first?
I could go.
Oh, Meghan, let's hear it.
One thing I really like to make is chili cheese fries. And in the autumn, I can do that pretty much from stuff from my garden. So we've got the potatoes for the fries. And then there's that wonderful recipe for making carrot potato cheese. And it's basically like a kind of a nacho sauce that's mostly made out of carrots and potatoes. It's like one of the most healthy and inexpensive vegan cheeses someone can make. And then chili from all the, the beans that we harvest at this time of year, the tomatoes that we still have left over. Even things like, you know, zucchini can go in. So yeah, it's one of my favorite meals. And also, you know, at this time of year, we can also be making fresh salsas from our tomatoes and onions and garlic and things like that. So it makes a really nice meal altogether.
Well, I don't know about you, but I'm feeling hungry. I had my curry today. Nearly every day in the Bryant household is actually a curry day. We used to live in India, so we are partial to it. And though the main body of the curry wasn't from the garden, some of it was. And I always like to try and put something, even if it's a bit, something that I've grown, put my energy into. So who's next then? Favourite seasonal dish. Piers, over to you.
Well, here I've got a little pumpkin that I grew in my plot this year. And you see, it's not a very big pumpkin. And actually, I like to grow them this size because this is a perfect size for a meal for two. And it's really thick skinned. It's been cured in the sun. So this will store really well in a shed or a garage. This will store for several months. But eating it now, it's the perfect autumnal dish. And my favorite way of doing it actually is to have it in a risotto, maybe with mushrooms or something like that. And the trick is with pumpkin is to cut the flesh up into tiny cubes. And I mean, maybe just a centimeter cubed, and then cook them first, either by frying them in olive oil or baking them in the oven in oil until they start to caramelize and they get a bit crispy and really sweet. Meanwhile, cook your risotto in the normal way, and then about 5 minutes before it's ready at the end, just tip these lovely crispy cubes of pumpkin flesh into the risotto, give it a good stir, a few more minutes, and then it'll be ready to eat. And it's really delicious.
Wow, that is, I think tomorrow I have got my dinner sorted. Ella, Mary, finally over to you.
They both sounded delicious. Sorry, they both sounded so yummy. I actually do feel hungry for real.
Yeah. Well, you've got a nice dinner coming. So
Yeah, I do.
So have you got a favourite autumnal dish?
Mine's actually a squash, a butternut squash. It's that time of year, isn't it? I know, I like you showed the pumpkin. There's so much wastage over pumpkins. People carve them and bin them, but don't forget to put them on your compost. But also, of course, you can eat the lovely insides. But butternut squash, chop it in half, scoop out all the seeds. Don't forget to save them so you can sow them for the following year, and then put a bit of olive oil on, chuck them in the oven. They take a while, about 40 minutes. While that's cooking, just throw all like your spare veg, basically chop it up, put it in a frying pan, salt, garlic, pepper, some quinoa maybe as well, even some chickpeas, mash it all up, cook it all up, and then stuff your butternut squash. So one butternut squash in half, and that's one half each, and they're really filling as well. Take them back out of the oven, scoop out some of the flesh and mix it in with what you've just made in the frying pan, and then put it all back into the squash and put it back in the oven for a few minutes. It is absolutely delicious. And if you want to make it a bit fruity, you could maybe squeeze a bit of orange or some orange zest, or you could put some like dried cranberries on it or some pomegranate even. Like, just use up what you've got, and easy and delicious.
Wonderful. I tell you what, I am super hungry. And dear listener and viewer, I hope you have thoroughly enjoyed this session today. I'd like to give a very special thanks to Meghan and Mary and Piers for your wisdom. And thank you, everyone. I'd really encourage you all to support the Vegan Organic Network. Have a look at the fantastic website and share and like on social media. Do all that sort of stuff. Do check out also the wonderful work of the panelists, because first time I've met them virtually here, but look forward to getting to know you and your work a lot more. So thank you, everyone, for being part of this wonderful show. Apologies if we didn't answer your questions, but I do believe that this sort of thing happens every month or so. So I'm sure those questions will get answered. So thank you, panel.
Thank you. Thank you, Giles. It's been really good fun. It's great to meet Meghan and to see you again as well, Piers. And thanks for everyone who's listening. Happy World Vegan Day. Make the world vegan.
Go vegan.
Yeah, let's do it. Thank you all.
Many thanks to our panel and to you for watching. Please support and join us on our veganic mission to be part of a worldwide movement for a peaceful, just world where agriculture is earth, animal, and human friendly.